Lord. It's time to begin. So why don't we stand and worship the Lord tonight? Thank you, Jesus, for a beautiful Sunday evening to come together to worship you, to lift you up. We're gathered in your name, and we know that you're here in our midst. We worship you and love you and thank you, God, for your wonderful presence. Thank you, Jesus. Yes, Lord. Yes, Jesus.
Pressing on higher ground tonight. I'm pressing on the upward way. New heights I'm gaining every day. Still praying as I onward bound. Lord, plant my feet on higher ground. Lord, lift me up and let me stand. My face on head. Arise and fears dismay. Though some may dwell, well, these are bound. My pray, my aim is higher ground. Lord, lift me up and let me stand. My face on heaven, table land, a higher plane than I have found. Lord, plant my feet on higher ground. I want to live above the world, though Satan starts at me on earth. For faith has called the joyful sound, the songs of saints on higher ground. Lord, lift me up and let me stand, my face on heaven, table land, a higher plane. Still I'll pray till heaven I found. Lord, lead me on to higher ground. Lord, lift me up and let me stand. My face on heaven, table land, a higher plane than I have found. Lord, plant my feet on. I want to scale most high and catch a gleam of glory bright, but still I'll pray till heaven I found. Lord, lead me on to higher ground. Lord, lift me up and let me stand by faith on the head, a table land, a higher plane than I have found. Lord, plant my feet. Verse 3, I want to live above the world, through Satan darts at me on earth. For faith has called to a joyful sound, the song of saints on higher ground. Lord, lift me up and let me stand, my face on heaven, table land. Your plane that I have found. Lord, plant my feet. One more time, church. Lord, lift me up and let me stand. My face on heaven, table land. A higher plane than I have found. Lord God for salvation. Hallelujah. Praise His holy name. Yes, oh God Almighty. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Victory shall be mine. Hallelujah. Victory, victory shall be mine. Victory, victory shall be mine, oh my. If I hold my peace and let the Lord fight my battles. Victory, oh victory. Victory, victory shall be mine. Love, love, love shall be mine. Love, love shall be mine, oh my. If I hold my peace and let the Lord fight my battles. Love, oh love, love, love shall be my peace. Peace, peace shall be mine. Peace, peace shall be mine, oh my. If I hold my peace, let the Lord fight my battles. Peace, oh joy, hallelujah, joy, joy shall be mine, joy, joy shall be mine, oh my, if I hold my peace, let the Lord fight my battles, joy, oh joy, joy, love, love, love. Shall be mine, oh my. If I hold my peace, let the Lord fight my battles. Love, oh love, love, love shall be. Thank you, Lord God, for the victory. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Thank you, God.
Amen. We thank you for that joy and that love. Lift up our voices in this place. We give you all the honor and glory. Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. You may be seated tonight. I was about to say this morning, but it is tonight. So God bless you all. Welcome to the house of the Lord. Amen. In for a wonderful blessing tonight. And we're going to give the opportunity to pay tithe and give in the offering. And have a Rochelle, could you please help us out, sir? Pray over the gift and the giver. Thank you, sir. Thank you for your giving. This time, sister's going to sing a special.
You've heard the story of Paul and Silas, how they were bound and thrown into jail. They didn't worry, they kept on praying, 'cause they were serving a God that could not fail. God sent an earthquake. Like those Hebrew children from that fire he freed. Like he fed 5,000 with two fishes and bread. And he walked on the water and he raised the dead. Stood by Daniel in the lion's den. And he saved old Moses from Pharaoh's men. Opened the eyes of the blind to see. And I know.
Jesus. Something else, babe. Come on, let's worship God tonight. Let's glorify Him. Let's worship God. Let's praise Him tonight. Father, we thank You and praise You, glorify You tonight. Lord, we just don't want to rush through service, but God, we want Your presence to be felt here. And Lord, we just want to worship You and magnify You, lift You up, God. Help us, Holy Spirit, come and be with us and help us and lead us, Holy Spirit, to worship the Father tonight, to glorify God, and to praise Him this evening. Hallelujah. Thank You, praise You, glorify You, wonderful God. Let's give God a clap offering this evening. Hallelujah. Thank You, Jesus. Come on, let's worship God tonight.
The splendor of the King, clothed in majesty, let all the earth rejoice, all the earth rejoice. He ran. Darkness tries to hide and transform. and all will see how great is our God.
Sing it again. How great.
How great is our God. Sing with me, how great is our God. And all will see how great is our God.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Praise the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Then the king of Syria warred against Israel and took counsel with his servants, saying, in such and such a place shall be my camp. And the man of God sent unto the king of Israel, saying, beware that thou pass not such a place, for thither the Syrians are come down. We use verse 9 as my text tonight. And the man of God sent unto the king of Israel. See, it wasn't the king of Israel sending to the man of God. This is coming out of 2 Kings chapter 6, verse 8 and 9. It wasn't the king of Israel giving the man of God some advice. It's the man of God giving the king of Israel advice. Amen? It's the man of God that's closer to God than the king of Israel was closer to God. He said, and the man of God sent unto the king of Israel, saying, beware that thou pass not such a place, for thither the Syrians are come down. I'm going to use that and preach in the title, Gaining the Upper Hand. Gaining the Upper Hand. Brother Dawood, will you please pray, sir? Yes, Jesus. Amen. Amen. So, in our Bible reading, or in that passage, in that area, the man of God, Elisha, had warned the king. The king against going to a certain place because the Syrians had gotten together. Their council, the king and his private council, or those that were closest to him, got together. They got together and talked about where they were going to go to war, how they were going to capture the Israelites, and how they were going to overcome them. But there was something that was missing. Something that was missing in their capabilities, and it was that God was missing out of their camp, but they didn't realize and understand. God was right there in the camp of the Syrians, right along with the ones that were closest to the king, because it was God that heard the king of Syria talk about how that he was going to capture the Israelites. But God had spoken to the man of God and let him know and helped him understand, even to the point to where the king of Syria even began to question, who is among us that's the spy? Who's among us that's telling? There's somebody that's closest to us here. And they begin to speak about how close of a knit of group of men that it was, even in his bedchamber, even that close, that somebody had shared what the king of Syria was going to do to the children of Israel and how they were going to overcome the army. But God had an upper hand. God gave the upper hand to his prophet. God gave an upper hand to his children. God gives an upper hand to his children. Amen. God gives us always the upper hand against the devil. You just have to be looking for it, listening for it, watching for it, keeping your eyes on the prize of Jesus Christ, keeping your mind focused on the Word of God, and God will give you always, as his child, the upper hand. We've got to gain the upper hand in this fight of Christianity, because the devil is no simple foe. The devil will try to use all the tricks of the trade, and we have to have the upper hand. We may be powerless against the devil, but with God, amen? With God, we can overcome anything. With the Spirit of God, nothing can stand against us. With the Spirit of Almighty God, nothing can defeat us. Why? Because it's God's Spirit that lives in a Christian, and God cannot die, amen? Said, and the king of Israel sent to the place which the man of God told him and warned him of and saved himself there, not once nor twice. Therefore, the heart of the king of Syria was sore troubled for this thing. And he called his servants and said unto them, will ye not show me which of us is for the king of Israel? Which one of us is the spy? He said, one of his servants said, none, my lord, O king, but Elisha, the prophet that is in Israel. Tell it, the king of Israel, the words that thou speakest in thy bedchamber. And he said, go and spy where he is, that I may send and fetch him. And it was told him, saying, behold, he is in Dothan. Therefore sent he thither horses and chariots and a great host. And they came by night and compassed the city about. They wanted to get a hold of this man of God and get him out of the equation. Because with that man of God, with that came God himself to defend and fight for and give the children of God, the children of Israel, I should say, the upper hand. They gained the upper hand because God was on their side, because the prophet of God was appointed over them to help them and guide them and give them the victory, even though they were always a smaller army. So he sent horses and chariots and a great host of an army to come and get this prophet. And when the servant of the man of God was risen early and gone forth, behold, an host compassed the city both with horses and chariots. And his servant said unto him, alas, my master, how shall we do? This is the end now. Can you see all the host of all the Syrians and all the army that are here against us? It's doomsday. We're done. Our fate is sealed. But God helped the prophet see a little bit higher. You've got to raise your view a little bit higher than what this physical carnal can see. Don't look around you and say, oh my goodness, look at all the bad things that are happening around me, all the things that are rising up against me. Just be patient, wait on God, and God will deliver to you what you're in need of. God will bring to you what you have need of in your life, whatever it might be. If you serve God, if you live for God, if you give to God what is due to God, when you pay tithe, when you give an offering, when you support the work of God, when you give of your heart and your life, when you give of your time to God, when you spend time with God in His Word, you spend time with God in prayer, you spend time with God in soul winning, all of those things, God won't forget you. God will be there for you. God will bless you. You'll open up your eyes one day and say, wow, how did all this become mine? God continues to pour out showers of blessings upon the men and women that serve Him, that live for Him, that do for Him, that are just committed to Him. Amen? Amen. He said, look at this. Look at all of what's going on. And the man of God had a message for the servant. I'll chop it up just for a moment. Verse 16, he simply said to his servant, fear not. Fear not. God has not given the Christian the spirit of fear, but of love, of power, and of what? A sound mind. That's what God gives a Christian. A spirit of power and of might, of sound mind, a spirit of love towards one another, not a spirit of hatred or a spirit of spite or this worldly mindset. But God gives us His Spirit. He said to His servant, "Fear not, for they that be with us are more than they that be with them." Don't fear when somebody serving the Lord with you leaves and quits serving God because they were not of us. They went out from us because they were already not of us. They didn't have it in their heart to want to continue to serve God. So you're going to see people over the lifespan of your time serving God. Somebody will walk away from serving God. Doesn't mean that we don't love them. Doesn't mean that we don't stop praying for them. Doesn't mean that we don't stop reaching out to them. We do all of those things. But in their heart of hearts, they didn't have the desire that you have to continue on and make it all the way to the end. Amen? Amen? He said, "Fear not, for they that are with us are more than they that are against us." After we were soul winning yesterday, I was driving home and I was looking around, just driving through and looking at people, just watching people and thinking to myself, God, look how crazy the devil has this world. Look how wild the devil has so many people caught up in trying to be happy in this world instead of looking to the next one that's going to come, the world that's going to come, the heavenly host that we're going to be a part of, the heavenly eternal time that we're going to spend with God. And not being discouraged at all. I just don't get discouraged. Thank you, Jesus. Maybe at one time, but not now, because I realize and understand there's a greater fight going on than this world ever can deliver or have to offer. But this came to heart. They that be with us is far greater than they that who are against us. And Elisha prayed, "Lord," he said, "I pray thee, open up his eyes. Open up this servant's eyes and let him see, God, what you've granted me to see. Open up his eyes and let him experience, God, what you've allowed me to experience." He said, "Lord, I pray thee, open his eyes that he may see." And the Lord opened the eyes of the young man, and he saw, and behold, the mountain was full of horses and chariots of fire round about Elisha. So they may have encamped and encircled Elisha or Dothan the city, but when he looked up at the mountains all the way around, could you imagine if God were to allow us to open up our eyes and see all the host of all the angels, all the chariots, all the horses that were on the ridge line there in Hawaii, the H3. Somebody who drove over the H3 through the tunnel yesterday, and they had a video, and I saw the mountain and how high it just scales this island, and thought, what about if all there was angels that were all the way around, a host of horses all the way around, and they're on here on this island on whose behalf? Not on everybody's behalf here, but on my behalf, on your behalf, on the Christian's behalf. God's got us. The devil may have you encircled. The devil may have you trapped at times, you may think, but God doesn't leave you. God doesn't forsake you. God doesn't walk away from you. God has angels around the army of the devil, and always can conquer at any time, can wipe them out. You just have to believe and trust. God, I believe if you did it there, then you'll do it from here for me also. Amen? Amen. You don't have to fear. You don't have to be in doubt. You don't have to wonder if God's going to take care of you. You can rest assured. God, if you took care of the prophet of God, if you took took care of Israel when they weren't even doing right by you, if you took care of the servant of the prophet, then surely you're going to take care of me, one who has taken on salvation, one who is born of the Spirit of God, one who is washed in the blood of Jesus Christ, one who is baptized in with and of the Holy Ghost. Surely, God, you're going to take care of us also. There was a process of proving. And David had not proved the armor of Saul. But David had proved the Spirit of God. He didn't prove the armor of Saul. And when he went out to go and see, because his father had told him to go see how the army of Israel was faring against the Philistines, Bible says that he rose up early in the morning and he left the sheep with a keeper and took and went as Jesse had commanded him. And he came to the trench as the host was going forth to the fight. Israel and the Philistines had put the battle in array, army against army. And David left his carriage in the hand of the keeper of the carriage and ran into the army and came and saluted his brethren. While they were there, the champion of the Philistines, Goliath, he spake. David had heard this great giant speaking against the armies of Israel. And the children of Israel, the army, the men of Israel, when they heard Goliath speaking, they fled. They were afraid. The Bible says that they fled, being sore afraid. They were afraid of this Philistine, this giant. He was greater than any of the children of the armies of the men that were in the Israel's army. Greater and bigger and mightier than anybody on the Philistine side of the mountain. The Bible spoke about him as being a man of war. So great and big that he even had somebody carrying his shield for him. I've thought about that in the past, thinking, what good is the shield if somebody else is carrying it for you? It's only going to cover where that guy covers it in front of, or protects you in front of him. But if I was that dude and that guy was that big and this shield was big enough to where I had to carry it, surely I would be protected behind it before Big Dum Dum got protected. David came and saw what was going on and realizing what was going on, he spoke to the children of Israel. He said, what shall be done to the man that killeth this Philistine and taketh away the reproach from Israel? David wasn't worried about being killed by him. David wanted to know, what reward is there going to be for the one that takes this dude out? Maybe he wanted to hear. Let me hear if the reward was worth the challenge. And he even said, for who is this uncircumcised Philistine that he should defy the army, the armies, not of Israel, but he should defy the armies of the living God. David always was looking a little bit higher than carnal man's sight was looking. David was looking higher. He said, not who defies the armies of Israel, but who defies the armies of not a dead God, but who is defying the armies of our living God. David looked at it and saw, God is alive, and I'm going to be alive no matter what happens in this battle. And there's going to be somebody somebody that's going to go down there and beat this guy. David had gained the upper hand earlier on in his life, and he even told Saul, they brought this armor to David. And David had not proved this armor, and he even shared that, "I haven't proved this armor, nothing about this armor that you're giving me. It was cumbersome, it was too big, it was not right for him, it didn't fit him right." But they had put it on him, and they put it on him, and they dressed him up ready to go and fight against this Philistine. And David, realizing, "I've never even gone and fought against a little cat with this stuff. I haven't even taken out a goat with this stuff. I haven't even wrestled one of the sheep with this armor on." But David had done something before that with just his bare hands. David was a keeper of the sheep, and while he was out there shepherding the flock, there was a lion, there was a bear that came up against him to take out some of the sheep, and God helped David to overcome them with his bare hands, not with the armor, not with all the stuff that all these armies would have, but David was able to overcome these things by the Spirit of God. David had proved God over and over. God had put David out there to be a shepherd of the sheep to help him understand, "David, anything that comes against you," maybe that was a low degree type of a job. David wasn't out there with the army fighting. David wasn't out there with the sword taking out different ones. But David, he proved God when he was a shepherd boy. He proved God with just watching over the flock. That's where God proved David. That's where David proved that God would help him, and the Spirit of God would descend upon David, and David would go out and do all these great things. God was with David through his life, and he said, he even shared it one time, "God, take not thine spirit from me." Because the Spirit of God would descend upon David at different times in his life. Now, when a Christian gets filled with the Holy Ghost just stays with that Christian. Say, can I ever lose the Spirit of God? Sure you can. Can I ever do something to where the Spirit of God leaves you? Sure you can. Why not? If you get filled with the Holy Ghost and then go out there and just blatantly live in sin, why would God stay living inside of you? But David proved God, and God was proving David. David wasn't even realizing, did not even realize when he was taking care of the flock that God would be proving him for a later battle. God was giving David the upper hand. He was gaining the upper hand throughout his time with God, this relationship that he was building with God. You are gaining the upper hand as you grow in God. You can't stay stagnant in God. You must keep growing in God. David said to Saul, "Thy servant kept his father's sheep, and there came a lion and a bear and took a lamb out of the flock. And I went out after him and smote him and delivered it out of his mouth. And when he arose against me, I caught him by the beard and smote him and slew him. Thy servant slew both the lion and the bear, and this uncircumcised Philistine shall be as one of them, seeing he had defied the armies of the living God." David said, "Moreover, the Lord that delivered me out of the paw of the lion and out of the paw of the bear, he will deliver me out of the hand of this Philistine." And Saul said unto David, "Go, and the Lord be with thee." Go ahead, David. Go do your thing. Not, "Come on, David, I'm right there with you. I'll be behind you to protect you. Watch if in case anybody else tries to jump in." Mm-mm. David said, go. You go. Maybe he had faith that, wow, I can have faith in this kid because he proved that God was going to take care of him. Or he was just scared himself. Whatever it is, he sent him on his way. David, after going through and taking all this armor off, Bible says that he took in his hand his staff. He had a sling, and he took five smooth stones, put them in a shepherd's bag, which he had, and he took his sling in his hand, and he drew near to the Philistine. We know the story of what took place. David said to the Philistine, you come to me with the spear and the sword. But David said, I come to you in the name of the Lord. And when David went out there and he took that sling and put that stone in it and he let that thing fly, it hit Goliath in the forehead. Can you see yourself this evening? Whatever battle you're in tonight, whatever demon you're facing, whatever devil is rising up against you, just see yourself. You say, Pastor, I'm not a mighty warrior. I can't go to battle. Well, guess what? David wasn't a mighty warrior either. He was not a part of the army of Israel. David was just that shepherd. He would grow into becoming the king of Israel. But God was proving him, and David, throughout his journey with God, throughout all of his ups, and we know that David had some down times, but throughout all of his journey with God, the ups and the downs, God would bring him through it and put him up on a mountaintop, and he would become king of Israel. He took that sling and let that stone fly out of that sling, and it hit Goliath in the forehead to where it crushed into his skull, and he fell over. And David took Goliath's own sword out of his sheath and finished the job. God had blessed David with having a sense of trust and belief in God. Tonight, God is giving you the upper hand as a Christian. He gave us the upper hand when Jesus Christ died on the cross and rose from the grave. He gave us the upper hand when he said, I'm going to be with my Father and I'll send you another comfort, the Holy Ghost, and he will dwell with you and be in you. We were talking yesterday about people that Christians, the best kept secret that Christians don't hear about is being filled with the Holy Ghost and speaking in other tongues as the Spirit of God gives you utterance. And it's for every Christian. Every last Christian should have a desire and want to be filled with the Holy Ghost. And when you are, you will speak in other tongues as the Spirit of God gives you utterance. Say, well, I already got filled with the Holy Ghost. How do you know? Because I just am. Let's just bounce it off the Word of God and look and see. I speak in other tongues as the Spirit of God gives me utterance, and I do it whenever I go into prayer. And then you look at the Bible and see, boy, they were being filled with the Holy Ghost and speaking in other tongues. But people today say, you don't need to speak in tongues in order to be filled with the Holy Ghost. Then how does the Holy Spirit pray through you? Said that there would be utterings that you can't even understand, but it's the Spirit of God praying through you for the things that you need that you don't know that you need. I think that's Romans 8:26. You have to walk, you have to explain that away. When they were getting filled with the Holy Ghost in the upper room. And then later on, when Peter and Paul were out there preaching, they even said they got filled with the Holy Ghost even as we did at the first. The Spirit of God descended upon them and filling them and baptizing them and giving them the unction of praying in this Holy Ghost language. The Holy Ghost speaking in other tongues is a heavenly language that the devil cannot understand, but it's a language that God by the Spirit is praying to the Father. Not everybody believes in it, but that's all right. I think about it this way. If it's a gain for me, why would I refuse it? And if it's something that's not, something that's no harm to the devil, why does he fight so hard against it? And the operation of the Holy Ghost in the church is prevalent because Jesus said, I'm going to go and be with my Father, and I'll send the Holy Ghost. And he will lead you and guide you unto all truth. Paul had proved God. Not only was Jesus Christ evident in his appearing to Paul on the road to destruction, you know, he was going to Damascus to destroy the church, but God got a hold of Paul. And God spun Paul over and turned him in another direction to the point where God, even the Holy Ghost, Jesus Christ, even appearing to him and blinding him, took away his capability of leading himself. He said, Paul, it's hard for you to fight against me, because he was fighting against Jesus Christ. He said, go and I'll tell you what you're going to do. And Paul went into the town and went to a friend's house. And from there, God led Paul away for, was it 3 years, out into the desert. And God, Jesus Christ, would train Paul the way that he wanted him to preach. He said, I conferred not with flesh and blood, but the training that I got it from Jesus Christ. And Paul came with boldness. And Paul, you have to understand, he was, what's the right word when somebody is indoctrinated? He was indoctrinated into a religion that was wrong. And God had to get all that out of his heart, get all that out of his mind, straighten all that out, and help him understand, this is what is truth, Paul. God was proving Paul. God was proving the disciples. God proved you. God is continuously proving you. And in proving you, God is giving you the upper hand every day that you live for him. We've got the upper hand in God. And never, ever let yourself forget, I've got the upper hand. I'm a child of God. There's nothing that can come against me that can defeat me. Amen? It's right up here. Right up here. Positive mental attitude. I want, come on. Come on, babe. Come get ready to sing. Come on, stand to your feet. Let's worship God tonight. I remember my sons getting ready to go to school for the first time. Pre-K or kindergarten, whatever it was. And I don't know where I got this. I'll just give God the credit. But I would ask them almost on a daily basis before they would get ready to go to school. I'd get in front of them at the door and kneel down in front of them, and I would say, hey. And they'd look at me with these big old eyes, and I'd say, who's the best kindergartner in your class? And they'd say, after a while, they got the message. They understood. They'd say, stick their chest out, and they'd say, me. And I'd say, who's the best kindergartner in your school? And they say, me. So who's the best kindergartner in your city? Me. How about the best kindergartner in your state? That's me. How about the best kindergartner in your country? Me. How about the best kindergartner in this world? I'm the best kindergartner in this world. And I say, you go to school and you have that mentality and you have that thought process, and it works even to this day. Who's the best in your city? Who's the best in your God? And you can say, I'm the best, not because of me, but because of the God that I serve. Because if it was just me, I would be the old me, the one that had to get saved. That was the best that I could do. But the new me, the one that where Christ delivered me, the one that Christ forgave, God has made me the best me that I can possibly be. And who's the best Christian? You can say, me. Why? Not because of me, but because of the God that I serve. Because of the blood that's been applied to my life. Because of the Holy Spirit that dwells in me. That's why I'm the best. Not because of me, but because of the God that we serve. Amen? Come on, let's find a place to pray. Let's look to God tonight. God is giving the upper hand every time we turn around. God is blessing you with the upper hand. In one fashion, one way or another, God is always wanting to give you, the Christian, the upper hand to fight and win and defeat the devil at any hand, any time that he tries to come against you. If you need to get filled with the Holy Ghost, come down to the altar and pray and say, God, lift up your hands and lift up your voice and say, God, fill me with the Holy Spirit tonight, and then begin to speak in other tongues as the Spirit of God gives you utterance. Something's not going to come over you and just take you and possess you. You've got to pray in the Holy Ghost yourself and have faith and believe and trust. This is God filling me with the Holy Spirit and the indwelling of the Holy Ghost, and God will begin to meet with you, and God will begin to strengthen you, and God will begin to give you the faith and the courage to continue on and go higher in Him. Amen? Come on, let's find a place to pray tonight. Oh, we thank you and praise you, Father. God, thank you for this service right now. Accomplish your will in this service, God. If there's anyone that needs to be filled with the Holy Ghost, Lord, lead them down to this altar that they would come and pray and be filled with the Holy Spirit. If there's anyone that needs to be saved, Lord, that they would come and ask you for your forgiveness. God, if there's anyone that needs to be healed, Lord Jesus, that they would come and ask for the church to lay their hands on them and be healed of any infirmities that they have in their body or in their mind or anything that's going on. God, if there's anyone that needs prayer tonight, if they would come forward, Lord Jesus, that you would answer their prayer, God. Oh, we thank you and praise you, God. We magnify you, Lord Jesus. God, have your way. Accomplish your will, Lord Jesus. Oh, Lord, hallelujah. Thank you, God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Oh, praise you, God. Hallelujah. Thank you, God. Thank you.
From the throne, the blood
can see your holy face and your throne in heaven above. It seems so far away, and though I can touch your nail-scarred hands, I have a deep and unspeakable joy that makes my faith to stand. Lord, I believe in you. I'll always believe in you. Though
Jesus. Glory to you, God. Hallelujah. We thank you. We praise you, God, for the Holy Ghost. Jesus, we thank you for salvation. God, thank you for the Holy Spirit, Jesus. Oh, yes. Come on, let's sing this together.
With a pure heart, I'll love you. And with the right spirit within me, I will magnify your name. I will magnify your name. Lord, I'll magnify your name with a heart that's full of love for you. I will magnify your name. With a clean heart, I'll praise you. With a pure heart, I'll love you. And with the right spirit within me, I will magnify your name. I will magnify your name. Lord, I'll magnify your name with a heart that's full of love for I will magnify your name. I will magnify your name. Lord, I'll magnify your name with a heart that's full of love for you. I will magnify your name. With a clean heart, I'll praise you. With a pure heart, I'll love you. And with a right spirit within me, I will magnify your name. I will magnify your name. I will magnify your name with a heart that's full of love for I will magnify your name.
Come on, let's just worship God tonight. God, we thank you and praise you for your presence here tonight. God, thank you for the Holy Ghost baptism, Lord Jesus. Lord, anyone seeking to be filled with the Holy Spirit tonight, God, we pray that if they're not filled with the Holy Spirit, that, Lord, that you would do the work that Jesus, you said you would do in their heart and their life. God, fill with the Holy Ghost. Move in this church, God. God, let your presence be known and felt, Lord Jesus. Lead this congregation, Lord Jesus. God, cause this congregation to be an impact, to have an impact on the men and women's lives in this island, Lord Jesus. God, let them be a peculiar people. Let them be a different people. Let them be an example of holiness, Lord Jesus. God, of righteousness, Lord Jesus, of men and women that live, that love you, and that serve in you. God, we thank you and praise you this evening for the Holy Ghost, for the washing and cleansing by the blood of Jesus Christ. Father, for the redemption plan that you set forth for mankind. We thank you, praise you, glorify you tonight. Jesus' wonderful name. And the congregation said, amen. Praise the Lord. Let's go fellowship. Amen. God filled with the Holy Ghost tonight. God moved and blessed. Let's just continue to have that same spirit of love and of fellowship as we go upstairs and fellowship and just have a good time. Prayer meeting tomorrow night, 8 o'clock. Make it. Come on, let's pray together. Let's worship together. Let's pray. It's only an hour. I said, Pastor, that's right before my bedtime. Okay, and? God bless the time that you don't get to go to sleep early. God bless your sleep even more so. I've always firmly believed that. Whatever I give to God, if I took away from something else, God would bless that even more so. And I've never been let down. Amen? So praise the Lord. Bless you all. See you tomorrow night at 8 o'clock and Bible study on Tuesday night, 7:30 right here. Praise the Lord.